Kate Malone, and I'm one of the reference and instruction librarians here.
So, okay, I'm bringing in more chairs, so come on into the meeting. So there are a few here. Raise your hand if there's a chair next to you.
A chair here, a chair over there.
A few more over here. There's a number over there.
glad that your librarian Kimberly pointed out some of these books that are in your library's collection. Some of this may be familiar to you. You've heard of Gone with the Wind, which is the image that we have here on the cover of this book. Black representation in film from the silent era to the current age has changed a great deal. We have traditionally stereotypical images. For example, in Gone with the Wind, how many people have seen Gone with the Wind? Yeah, several. Although it's widely considered a classic of American filmmaking, for its value of direction, art direction, the way the cinematography is presented, it does include many images that continue to be controversial until this day. For example, the slaves in the film are happy. Someone who has no control of their own life, when they can come and go, would that be a happy person? Yes. The slaves in the film are comic relief, and the Civil War is presented as something that had very little to do with slavery, a common argument today. Looks like Rebecca. We have some other books on history and film. Blackface. Is anyone familiar with this term? Yeah, so if you're familiar with the history of theater, if you've seen vaudeville history or old films, that's what happens when people who may not be black, because sometimes black actors in early silent film and later sound film would wear burnt cork on their faces to make themselves black. And people still do that today in contexts that are offensive. For example, some fraternities will do it, or some television performers will do it, without thinking of what that means to the people who are being misrepresented, or intentionally trying to mock the people they are misrepresenting. But let's get started with visual literacy. So, as a librarian, like the librarians here at Central, I teach some courses, and we talk about information literacy, where you're evaluating the kinds of information sources that you find. So you're not just going to pull something off the web, right? You stick it in your research paper. You have to cite it. You also have to evaluate it, make sure it's something that's accurate and something that is up to date, which might be important if you're researching, say, for example, prescription medications. You want to have current, correct research that is something that is appropriate for an academic project. These are some guidelines that were published by an organization called the Association of College and Research Libraries. It can get very long and complicated. I hope you can see this link. It will take you to the complete list of visual literacy standards. And what ACRL has done is look at an information cycle of sorts that relates specifically to how a student might search for and use an image. So define the image need. What kind of image might you want for a project? Examples, a map. What other kind of image would you look for? It could be a project you did recently. Anyone?
Painting.
A painting. So you might have a piece of art that you want to represent. Anyone else?
A graph.
A graph, yes. And a graph could be used in anything from a history research paper to a science paper. It could be a lot of different things. It might be something you create yourself. When you're finding images, yes, it's very easy to do a Google image search, but not everything's going to turn up in Google image search, and there are going to be rights and restrictions. So we're talking about copyright, Creative Commons licenses. There are going to be rules about how you use an image. And if you're in English 102, you're talking about citations, right? So you want to cite your image. You want to interpret and analyze images. So when I was talking about Gone with the Wind, I was talking about the kind of images of enslaved African Americans that show up in that film, and they continue to affect society today. Think about the type of image, whether or not it fits with your project, and what the meaning of it might be. That's also part of your evaluation process. You want to use it effectively. So that could mean a lot of things. You don't download the kind of scratchy looking JPEG version, perhaps. You want to use an image that relates to your text and has meaning. Or you could just make your own image. And is anyone here familiar with Creative Commons? A bit. If you decide to create an image, or even some video or audio, and release it on the web, you can put a Creative Commons license on it that tells people how to use it. So you can say that the image can be totally reused, and they don't have to ask you for permission, or for education use only, or for non-commercial use. You want to use them ethically. Confirmation bias. So if you're trying to make a point about a certain group of people and you find the most damning negative image that you can find to place next to your text, that's not really an ethical image use. You're using something that only presents one side of an argument, one point of view. Or ethical image use, of course, means stealing, using the image and not giving credit to the person who made it. Most important thing, always cite your source. So it actually gets to be an even bigger map. So if you look at some of the smaller circles, you see how they start to break it down into these subcategories. But since there's a lot there and it is so complicated, I just suggest that you look that up later. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how I used image evaluation as part of a research project I did. So does anyone know Washington Hall? Might have been there. It's at 14th and Fur, just off Gessler. One of the streetcars goes there. Okay. So Washington Hall, this lovely building, was constructed in 1908 by a lodge called the Danish Brotherhood of America. This is lodge number 29. In 2007, the building was owned at the time by an African-American Masonic lodge, the Sons of Haiti. And developers were coming into the part of Seattle, they were looking for buildings, and they were going to tear this building down. And I was hired as a researcher by For Culture of King County's Historic Buildings Department to work on the cultural history of the building. Washington Hall is a beautiful big old building. It's got two, you could describe them as ballroom spaces. There's also a stage and a theater. And in the back, so remembering we're going back to 1908, Seattle is changing. This was a place where a lot of young Danish men, when they came to America, would find single rooms to live in. The Danish Brotherhood would rent the ballrooms and its large library to any ethnic community in Seattle. Here's why that's important. Black groups would not have been able to rent halls to hold events. Jewish synagogues that did not have their own building would not have been able to rent large halls for things like the High Holy Days, for example, Purim celebration. Italians, until they had their own building, might not have been able to rent because of prejudices against specific groups. Japanese organizations, again, until they had their own buildings, may not have been able to rent. Those ethnic groups along with Serbians, and so I went through the records at the University of Washington Special Collections, big old ledger books. Sometimes they were written in Danish. After a certain year, as people's immigrant experience changed, they were in English. And I found rental records to many, many, many different ethnic groups. And I began to write this cultural history of the building for a landmarks preservation status application. The idea was to make this a King County landmark so that the building would not be destroyed. And then For Culture of King County worked with Historic Seattle to purchase the building. And a veterans program came in and renovated it. So over the years, this place has been home to literally people who needed a place to live. Marcus Garvey, anyone know who that is? The Seattle chapter of the United Negro Improvement Association held a fundraising book sale in Washington Hall. The local chapter of the NAACP, the Sons of Italy, the Jewish congregation that later became Congregation Vicar Poland. Before they built the building, that's the Langston Hughes Performing Arts Center. Anyone know where that is? It's on Yesler, gorgeous little building. Before that was finished, they were renting Washington Hall. This was also a place where political groups met, like the Finnish Socialist Society. At one time, Washington State was home to a lot of socialists and communists. And all of this is in a historylink.org essay that I wrote. So again, that's historylink.org, search for Washington Hall. In the last 20 years, this has been a place where dance groups, punk bands, they were having boxing there for a while, and now 206 Zulu, a Seattle hip-hop organization, their headquarters are there. There is an Ethiopian Orthodox church. Everybody has done all kinds of things. So, since I've been researching this building for almost 11 years now, I was asked to be a dramaturg for a play with music that was going to be produced. I wasn't going to be in the play, I wasn't going to write the play, I was going to be a dramaturg, something I hadn't done before. And that job involved creating some historical context and research that the playwright, director, and actors would be able to read. So this is a common thing that happens in theater. You need to have some context and background for your actors and the people who are directing them. So I wrote a 100-page book that was only shared among the theatrical group. And the play itself is, of course, about the first documented jazz performance by a local group in Seattle, Miss Lillian Smith's Jazz Band. So this is in 1918, June 1918, to be specific. What else was happening in the world in 1918? Yes, and that affected a lot of what happened at Washington Hall, for example, a lot of military fundraisers. So I had to do some research to provide context, and I had to think about what kind of material was going to be useful to the people I was working with. I'm not an actor. I'm not a theater director. I needed to think about what I wanted to show them. So I have a video clip, and I'd like to do this. So please take a slip of paper. There should be enough for everyone. Please get these out. Thank you. As you watch the clip, please just write a few notes about your reactions to it. And I'm not going to say a lot about it at first, because we're going to give some quick image evaluation. When you take an image completely out of its context, what does it mean? And it's a silent film from 1912. Thank you. What did we just see? What kind of dancing and let's talk about where it was.
Square dancing.
Yeah, some of them look like square dancing.
Jazzy.
Yes, jazzy. It's both square dancing and jazzy together. Has anyone here ever done swing dance?
Oh, I haven't done it, but I know.
I did about 2 years ago and was surprised to recognize one of the steps with the passing of the hand over the head as something I've done. The square dance is something called the Texas Tommy, which I believe people still do. So when we look at those dancers, and I'll play the clip again, sometimes we work with archival sources. So remember, we're thinking about something from a digital archive. There won't be a lot of information attached to it, and you kind of have to fill in what's there. This is part of your information evaluation process. So, if people are doing the Texas Tommy all the way in California, that tells me some of these people might be migrants. They might be part of the Great Migration, right? If you've done U.S. history, you know about the movement of blacks from the South to the West and North for better economic opportunity and freedom from violence. The Barbary Coast district of San Francisco, at the time, it was kind of this rough place with lots of drinking and theaters with kind of sleazy and maybe suggestive kind of performances and people out in the street. And what we know about the film itself is essentially nothing. So you'll notice that it's labeled Cool Cam number 5423. It's one of a small set of newsreel films that have been digitized and placed on archive.org. It's in the public domain, so I could take this, and if I was doing a DJ set, I could project it behind me, or I could decide I'm going to write a story about it, or anything. It's in the public domain. It can be reused. The Bellinger Archives have decided to make it accessible to the public. But we don't know the name of the photographer. We don't, of course, know the names of the people in the film. And they may have just been someone who the neutral photographer asked to come out into the street and show us what you do down here. We don't know any of that, which is why it made me really curious. A newsreel film, so we're going back to the old days of the films in theaters. I'll be right with you. Newsreel films would have been shown before feature-length movies. So we're going back to the days of silent film, where you would see many films on one bill. It's a little different from today, but based on the same model, where you see maybe five or six previews for what they want you to see next, and then you see the feature, so you're going to be there for 2.5 hours. But with this, it would just be part of the program. Because it's a newsreel film, this suggests to me that it might have been presented as a glimpse into the seamy underside of San Francisco, because the city did have that reputation still in 1914. But, of course, with limited info, I don't really know that for sure. What I did with the film is I added it as part of my dramaturgy kit so that the actors, director, and playwright could see it. And I showed it with them. I showed it to them, and we talked about it. None of this was used in the play that we put on in 2016, but it helped to show the larger context. It was 4 years earlier than this jazz performance in Seattle that the play was about, but it was something they could use to help themselves get character, right? They would understand this was part of the world that their characters would be familiar with. Question?
As I analyze the film, I can see that the people that are dancing, they're not from there. And I can tell this by the spectators that look like the locals, because they're looking at them like, what are you doing? You notice the gentleman that had his hand in his pocket. He's not applauding. He's kind of looking at like wondering what are they doing. And that's what, you got one or two spectators clapping. But for the most part, they're brand new to them, looking and trying to figure out what it is that they're doing. That's what I mean.
Yeah, and so you're starting the information evaluation analysis process, right, which is what you have to do. And you're thinking about reusing an image. What's another unusual thing? What about the way everyone's dressed?
Very well dressed.
Yes, people are in suits. And In 1914, a woman would not have gone on the street in trousers. And when you look at the way those are made, they've got a lot of fabric, so it looks like a divided skirt. So when I was trying to analyze what this might have meant, I thought, well, this is a lady who's maybe very self-directed. She's not concerned about people putting her down for wearing trousers, very modest trousers, but they're still trousers. So again, going back to the dramaturgy, and sorry, that's coming up part of the word there, I had to find some sources. I used old copies of the Seattle Times online that are available through the Seattle Public Library. I also used the Library of Congress. Has anyone visited the Library of Congress website? I recommend that you do. If you're interested in hearing what some of the early sound recordings, so this is before records, this is wax cylinders, the early, early days of recording sound, you can find that there. And I found a collection of newspapers published by a Seattle resident, Horace Caden. He was a black Seattleite, and he published two different newspapers. The first, which stopped publishing around 1908, was called the Seattle Republican. In those days, people associated Republicans with Lincoln. And so it was not unusual for a black community paper to be named the Seattle Republican. And all of this is free online at loc.gov. This is from his second paper, Cajun's Weekly. Look at the types of ads. And also, well, here's one address. So the kinds of services for that rural community. Some of them are personal services, obviously, hair culture, having your clothes mended. These are things that wouldn't necessarily have been handled by white businesses, and so people in Seattle would set these up. There is even a black-owned grocery, the Alhambra Cash Grocery. The Afro-American Hotel. There were several black-run hotels in Seattle, and this is just one. And over here we see Tut's Barbershop, high-class tonsorial work, that's an old term you don't hear much often. If you can see this, it says latest race papers. That means there were other black newspapers from around the country made available to read as you waited for your haircut. So one of the reasons this is important is it wasn't always easy to get these papers. So a few people knew about the Great Migration, right? Some black newspapers that were published in the North, for example, the most famous example, the Chicago Defender, published job ads that encouraged people to leave the South for a new life. And many southern towns would ban open sale of the Chicago Defender. The way people would get these newspapers was through Pullman porters sneaking the papers along with them on their jobs. Pullman porters worked on trains, so they were able to cross all of these state borders. And my own mother, I'm only 49, but my own mother remembers getting black paired newspapers brought to her small Louisiana town by men working on the trains. So people could secretly receive the papers and then make decisions about what they wanted to do. Also, you want to think about combining archives and data. So you want to think about things like census numbers. You can call this data. You could count the number of black businesses, for example, in Horace Caden's Weekly, and go through the archives and think about how you're going to present with a graph, perhaps, the information you find. So, again, apologize for the loose number there. So you've probably seen this, especially if you are in English 102, and if you've had a class with a librarian, you've gone through these information evaluation steps. This is something you can apply usually to text, but think about applying it to sources that you find that aren't text. So you want to talk about authority, who made it. Is there a bias? Are they trying to sell you something? Convince you of a certain point of view? Is it up to date? Documentation. Can they tell you a bit more about when it was made, how it was made, where it was made? primary sources in digital archives. So those advertisements that we looked at, those are primary sources. And I could use them in all these different ways. Sorry, the contrast on this is not that great. But a primary source, remember it comes first in time. So a primary source is a letter. It might be a diary or journal. It could be a book, if you're writing about it. The secondary source, so for example, primary source is a book. Secondary source is a book review. It's about the first thing and comes second in time. So I'm just going slightly off topic again. So again, we're talking about digital archives. We have a primary source. So if we read this image out of context, maybe it doesn't make sense, but I'm going to say a few things about it. It's from a newspaper called the Topaz Times. And everyone here has heard of Japanese internment during World War II. Yeah. So in the camps, people published their own newspapers that were distributed just within internment camps. And this is a cartoon from the Topaz camp, the Topaz Times. So it's just kind of a lighthearted cartoon from November 20, 1932. And if I just looked at this image without looking for details, I wouldn't really know what it's about. But look at the cabin. If you've seen photographs of internment camps, you know that, generally speaking, they were built on these risers above the ground. A lot of them looked like this, exactly. And I don't know if you can see it due to the resolution. So there are names on these slips. These are contest entries, like Helen, Yan, but there's also Kyo. And names that are Japanese names. So this tells me something about where this image was produced and when. The fact that people are using both their English names and their Japanese names. And it gives me a little information to the condition. And all of this is just to say that you can apply information evaluation to pretty much anything. So this is a second film clip. Same time, same place. So let's analyze this one. And let's talk through it while we're watching it. So what are we seeing? This time we're in a totally different place. We're no longer outdoors on the street. It's a private environment.
It's a lot quicker. And there's more than just one couple.
Yeah. So this is probably a place where, I mean, they've got a dance floor, so people go there expecting to dance. This is probably some kind of social club. What else are we seeing? Anybody?
Musicians. We didn't see them before.
How about people watching? Yeah, some of the liquor bottles on the table may help with that. But you know, it's kind of a friendly, relaxed place. Also, everyone's black. So there is unofficial, may not be on the books, segregation in social settings in San Francisco in 1914. So that tells me, again, a little bit more of what we know about the United States in 1914. Also, the film is somewhat decayed, so you know that the film reel itself might have been stored in an unsafe location or even forgotten. The style of dancing, now we're just having that. People are just showing their best steps now.
And there's a dog.
This is really a laid-back place because someone's dog's there, and now someone's petting the dog, and then someone says, oh, well, you know, let's go have the dog over here because we're filming.
They let you have fun. I see. They like to have a party.
Yes.
Dancing. Everywhere.
We don't know. There was nothing written on the camera. So this, again, evaluation process, you're filling in. So as part of additional research, if I was researching these clips, now I need to go find some text materials that tell me about this neighborhood in San Francisco, that tell me what African Americans might have been doing in this part of California at the time. And I also want to know a few things about 1914. So America has not yet joined the First World War, right? In 1914, I know that other things happening in the USA included lynchings. 51 black Americans are known to have been lynched in 1913. World War I begins in Europe the same year. The following year, the great leader and educator and spokesman, Booker T. Washington, dies. And in 1915, 56 black Americans are known to have been lynched. World War I, America enters World War I in 1917. 370,000 African Americans, men and women, were in military service. More than half of them ended up in France in the French war zone. And James Reese Europe, who was both a member of the army and a band leader, brought his African American band over. And part of that was the army's effort to keep the peace inspired, etc. And the French loved this new jazz, which many people hadn't been exposed to before. So I think I'm trying to make all of the connections between these different parts of history. You're going to want to think about other texts. You're going to read a history book. You're going to look at census records to put it together. Let's move 104 years into the future so that we have some time for discussion. So, to start, who here has not yet seen my video? I'm going to try to avoid the spoilers. I mean, don't you hate it when people see something and then they're talking about it and it's a mystery and they tell you who did it? And so, there aren't really any spoilers here, but I'm referring to some scenes as vaguely as I could. So here we have something which, if you've read the reviews or if you have heard some radio interviews with some of the actors, the director, there are a lot of reasons that Black Panther is being regarded as a somewhat revolutionary film. It does not include images like this. Instead, it functions with a liberatory narrative, you could say, where you see different types of collaboration and a type of political pan-Africanism, not only in the film's visual book, where real clothing worn by real people in different nations within Africa are combined. The costume designer, Ruth Carter, spent a great deal of time researching specific fabrics, items of jewelry and adornment, and styles of dress, and you see them in the film. For laying out the designer of the screenplay's name, the director, Ryan Coogler, if you have seen the films Fruitvale Station or Creed, then you know he's African American, and he's from Oakland. And he included in his production team a really diverse group. The cinematographer is a woman. For a big budget film, a Marvel film or any other film, especially an action film, that's really not a common thing. And collaboration and sharing. So, this is maybe not a spoiler. So, there are scenes in the film in which you see the cast members, you see Black Panther and the general, Danai Gurira in the red on the right, and also Lupita Nyong'o in the green on the left. They are speaking with each other in African languages. There's a scene where Lupita Nyong'o is involved in a rescue. And the rescue is modeled on a real historical event, the Chibok girls, the girls who were kidnapped in Nigeria. And they're speaking Hausa, which is just one of the many languages spoken in Nigeria. And one of the South African cast members taught the other cast members to speak Xhosa, South African language. And you hear that in the film. So visual literacy is, think of it as a tool that can help you as you select and research images for your academic projects And also, if you've got something of your own going on, you're writing about something, you're making something, think about how you're going to use these images. If you're a visually literate student, you can identify various image sources and materials. We talked about types, so you have graphs, you've got maps, photographs, film. You're going to think about how you're going to use it and how you can use it to communicate. And sorry, the rest of that is about, just gives examples of formats. You can remix, repurpose, reuse these images to make something completely new, but cite it. So I thank you for your time and attention. These are just a few research sources that I used for Washington Hall, for Jazz Intoxication and other projects. And also, of course, Shadow and Act is a film blog that I highly recommend because it discusses black film internationally, and many of the writers who are excellent go into deep analytical discussion about images and presentation. And of course, we have some really fine books in your own library collection. Talk to a librarian if you aren't sure whether or not an image is public domain. They can help you start your research and your analysis process to get there. If you don't know where to start looking, or if you want to learn about Creative Commons, talk to your librarian. You have some amazing librarians in Central. I may teach at North, but I love coming down here because there are so many interesting people on your library staff. If you ever want to get in touch with me for some reason, that's my email address. Since 2003, I've been the curator for the annual Langston Hughes African American Film Festival. We're coming up this April 19th through 22nd. And speaking of images, if you take a close look at the woman in the hat there, that is a photograph by Al Smith, an African American Seattle-based photographer. And right now at the Museum of History and Industry, South Lake Union, there's a beautiful exhibit of his gorgeous photographs that range approximately from the 40s to the early 60s, and I highly recommend that you see that. Thank you so much. I appreciate your time.
Yeah, me too.